Hello, I'm Alexander, and I'm glad to welcome you on my channel about first MTB simulator that I'm currently developing. You already can download a demo version with implemented MTB school, consists of 9 lessons, and try to pass them all. Website with the game could be found in the video description. In this video, I want to introduce you to the work of the bike suspension in simulator and to tell about suspension adjustments. Well, since this is a simulator, everything said is equally applicable to your real bike. Such suspension features as type, leverage and partly progressiveness are hard defined by bike construction and usually are not adjustable. But enough settings have two main elements of the suspension, fork and rear shock absorber. Not a single fork or shock absorber can do without an elastic element. It can be a spring or an air chamber. Everything is simple here. Choose a spring of such stiffness or inflate the chamber so strongly to provide the desired sag. Sag is a part of the stroke that the fork or shock absorber shrinks in when you are located on the bike in your attack position. Sag usually varies from 20 to 40% and depends on what trails you like to ride. More roots, stone and descents, more sag. More big jumps or ascents, less sag. Let's look at our rider. Who set his favorite sag and is going to land on the trail from a height of 0.5 meter? We see that after landing he bounces like a ball. And all because the sag setup is not enough. Our rider has fully opened the rebound and compression adjustments and rides on bare springs. It's not right to do so because it is dangerous. Because the suspension, instead of swallowing energy from bumps, happily gives it to you, trying to throw you off the trail. Our task is to slow down the spring when it's returning to rest position. It can be done by adjusting a rebound. The more the rebound is tightened, the slower the fork and rear shock absorber return the rest position. It's important to remember that having worked on one obstacle, the fork and shock absorber must have time to return to their rest position before the next obstacle in order to be able to handle it correctly. Therefore, the rebound must be fast enough to allow it. The height of 0.5 meter from which the rider is dropping is not random. Exactly this height allows the suspension to work on the full stroke. So, the rebound should be such as to allow the suspension to return to its rest position after triggering on full stroke in one iteration. Exactly this behavior bike demonstrates us. Thus, the rebound should be slow enough to eliminate spurious oscillation of the suspension, cutting them off at the first iteration, and fast enough to have time to return the fork and shock absorber to its rest position for each new obstacle. After adjusting the rebound, the suspension of our rider works much better. The parasitic oscillations have completely disappeared and the suspension no longer throws our rider out of the bumps. You can often find two rebound adjustments, low speed and high speed. High speed rebound allows you to reduce the force that prevents the compression of the fork or shock absorber in the event that the rod moves faster than a certain speed. The greatest acceleration of the rod is achieved at the moment when the wheels are unloaded and the rod is closer to the end of its stroke. Maximum acceleration leads to a rapid transition of the speed threshold between low speed and high speed rebound and the opening of an additional valve for oil transmission, reducing the resistance to decompression of the fork or shock absorber. In simple terms, an open high-speed rebound allows you to use a slower low-speed rebound while ensuring that the rod will be returning to its rest position faster at the end of its stroke. But what has just happened? Despite the adjusted rebound, our rider failed to land this table. The point here is in the suspension bottom-out. Let's change the condition of our experiment, rising the starting height from 0.5 to 1 meter. It is clearly seen that the fork and shock absorber work for the entire stroke before all the impact energy have been absorbed. And the residual part of the energy leads to the fact and that the rider throws a little up after landing. To fix the situation, there is another adjustment, compression. It is clearly seen that a bike with tuned compression successfully lands from 1 meter without bringing the suspension to a bottom out. Adjusting the compression allows you to change the force of resistance to movement of the rod during compression of the suspension. The strength of the resistance depends on the speed, and high speed and low speed compression is usually adjustable. The base resistance force is given by low speed compression, while high speed compression allows this force to be reduced if the rod moves with sufficient speed. Low speed compression is set in such a way that the suspension is not strongly shrinks on berms, kickers, and when pedaling. Upper limit is your sensitivity to small bumps. Small bumps do not allow the rod to have enough time to gain enough speed to open the high speed compression valve. Therefore, they are processed by a low speed compression circuit. As soon as you find a compromise between the unpleasant shake on small bumps and the swallowing of energy when pedaling on kickers and berms using low speed compression adjustment, you can proceed to high speed compression adjustment. Everything is simple here. If you don't bottoming out the suspension on the trail, leave high speed compression fully open. Otherwise, tighten it until the bottoms out go away or only small amount of them will left. Our rider has adjusted the suspension so that there will be no bottom out when falling from 1 meter to the plane. This may correspond to 3, 4 or even more meters of drops on a well-constructed landing. The demo version of the MTB game simulator does not contain suspension settings, but at your own risk you can adjust the suspension by editing the file data rider simple and bike .bps .presets. This is a text file that can be opened in a text editor. To understand what the parameters written there mean, we consider the damping function. It is represented by combinations of two functions of speed of the same type, the function of low speed and high speed damping. Each function has two constant parameters, scale and power. In addition, there are two points on the force axis that correspond to the beginning of the opening of the high-speed circuit valve and the complete opening of this valve. These two points define two more parameters of the damping function. The proposed option for specifying the damping function makes it possible to very closely repeat the characteristics of real dampers, both linear and nonlinear, for the allowable range of road speeds. Having remembered the main parameters of the damping characteristic, we consider the text file simple and bike BPS presets, which sets the suspension parameters. Front and rear shock absorbers are described by a set of parameters of the same name and type. Spring preload in newtons, spring stiffness in newtons per meter, progressiveness, and spring stroke. Stroke is a parameter that describes the actual travel of the suspension, but doesn't determine it. Therefore, changing it will not affect the suspension's role in any way, but will lead to incorrect calculations. The progressiveness parameter determines how the spring stiffness varies with time. With a value of 1, stiffness is constant. With value greater than 1, stiffness increases at the end of the stroke, and with values less than 1 at the beginning of the stroke. The recommended range of this parameter is from 1/5 to 5. The following is a description of the characteristics of rebound and compression. The meaning of the parameters of these characteristics was described earlier in the graph. If you decide to change the values in the file, I recommend saving its copy with the working values. The file with the characteristics obtained during the video can be downloaded from the link in the description. At this point, I'll say goodbye to you and don't kill yourself on the trails.